The Sandlot takes place in the summer of 1962, and Scott Smalls has just moved to the neighborhood with his mom and stepdad, Bill. Smalls desperately wants to make friends before the summer, so one day he puts on his smartest slacks with a sensible belt, tucks in his neatly pressed button-up shirt, dons a hat with the largest bill I've ever seen, grabs his plastic mitt and heads to the Sandlot. The Sandlot is the baseball field that the neighborhood kids go to play ball every day. Like, every single day. Actually, what they really do just kind of amounts to baseball practice, which was always the worst part of summer. Smalls is hanging out in the outfield when the leader of the team, Benny Rodriguez, hits a fly ball to Smalls and it knocks him down. Okay, that was embarrassing, but it's not the end of the world. Just brush yourself off and regroup. And, well, you had a good run. Time to convince your mom and Bill to move again. So instead of just giving up forever, Smalls asks Bill to teach him how to play catch. And Smalls gets a black eye and ruins his glove and strains his relationship with his stepdad even more. It is quite literally one of the worst games of catch ever. Like, seriously, Smalls would have been better off just not even waking up this morning. He's having a 24-hour period that would just break any small child and most adults. But luckily, Benny is the nicest kid in the world and asks Smalls to come play baseball with him.
Come on, let's go.
Of course, if I was Smalls, I would just think that Benny was setting me up for an extremely cruel prank. Like, for example, let's say Benny was only inviting him to come play because he had secretly invited a bunch of neighborhood girls to the Sandlot and would then proceed to force Smalls to throw a baseball in front of them. I'm not saying it happened to me, but just that if someone named, let's just make up the name, Jake Springer, did that to me, and let's say he hypothetically got the whole school to call me a rag-armed bitch for the rest of my middle school career, and would you blame me for not being upset in the slightest when Jake Springer died in a freak forklift accident 10 years later? You know, if that happened. So Benny doesn't suck shit, and he's being sincere when he offers Smalls his extra glove, and they head to meet up with the rest of the group, and Smalls already has one in with Benny, so he just needs to keep quiet until he figures out the social order of everybody else and what the power dynamic is.
I'm the Great Bambino.
Oh! Who's that?
You're killing me, Smalls. If you don't know what to say, say nothing. The Sandlotians consist of brothers Timmy and Tommy Timmons, whose parents must just be complete psychos, Mike Squints Palidorus, who had to have been the biggest loser on the team before Smalls joined him, Alan Yeah McClellan, Bertram Grover Weeks, who seems like he's too grown up. Like, if I was Smalls, Bertram would be that friend that I could probably get along with just fine when the whole group was there, but we would have nothing to talk about one-on-one. And you have Kenny DeNunez and Hamilton Ham Porter. And Benny's had enough of the idle chit-chat for the day, and they head to the Sandlot to play baseball for 9 hours. But even though Benny is the leader, the other guys still aren't loving the idea of having Smalls on their team.
Come on, Benny, man. The kid is a L7 weenie.
In any other social situation, someone like Squints would be the outcast. Squints has an inflated sense of self-worth. Like, he just happened to luck out with this group, and he should be way more accommodating to new members. Cause I guarantee he was hanging on by a thread before Smalls showed up. With Benny's help, Smalls learns to catch and throw the ball, and everyone finally accepts having Smalls on the team.
He's alright.
Very low barrier for entry with this group. You just need to catch a ball, throw a ball, and you better know who Babe Ruth is, or at least be able to lie about knowing who Babe Ruth is.
Oh, yeah, the Great Bambino. I thought you said the Great Bambi.
So Small's first non-sanctioned baseball practice was a success.
See you later, Ham. 8 o'clock tomorrow.
8 o'clock? Good God, Benny, it's summer. At the next practice, Ham hits a home run over the fence into Old Man Myrtle's backyard. And when Smalls tries to climb over the fence to get it, they freak out and tell him that it's gone forever because the beast lives there. He asks what the beast is, and they tell him to quietly and slowly go up to the fence and look through the hole. And again, Smalls is very trusting. For all he knows, they could have been luring him to peek through the fence. And when he got there, just off the top of my head, let's say someone named, let's just use the fake name Jake Springer again, has his butt up to it, and when you look through, he farts right in my eye. Smalls' eye. That kind of thing sticks with you. Like, you don't just move on from something like that. Although the realization that Jake Springer likely suffered a lot before succumbing to his injuries does help somewhat. Would help somewhat. Again, it's all pretend. But luckily, Smalls doesn't live in a dystopian hellscape ruled by a 12-year-old asshole who thinks he's hot shit because dad owns a video arcade. So when he looks through the hole, all he sees is a giant creature, and they decide to camp out in their clubhouse overlooking Old Man Myrtle's house. Squints then tells a story about how Old Man Myrtle was tired of having thieves stealing from his junkyard, so he trained the beast to eat them, and the authorities ordered the beast to be chained up forever. Squints and Yaya are buying a new ball when they spot Wendy Peppercorn walking down the street. My God. They get back to the Sandlot and they beg Benny to not play baseball for the day because it's too hot. And Benny tries to shame him for not wanting to succumb to heat exhaustion, but finally relents when they decide to go to the public pool where Wendy Peppercorn is a lifeguard. And upon seeing Wendy Peppercorn in a bathing suit, Squints becomes way too horny. But since he's a small child, he doesn't quite know how to handle it. So he does the only thing that makes sense to him at the time. He jumps into the deep end even though he doesn't know how to swim. Wendy dives in and pulls up an unconscious Squints. She begins to give him mouth-to-mouth when Squints shows that he was faking, and then proceeds to forcibly make out with her. Now, a lesser channel would make a big deal out of this. Yeah, it's weird, but it's just a harmless scene in a fun movie. There's no need to get all bent out of shape about it. Sexual predation! And a couple days later, Smalls gets them into the biggest pickle any of them has ever been in, after Benny knocks the guts out of a baseball. They don't have money for a new ball, and since Smalls is the dumbest smart kid ever, he swipes Bill's Babe Ruth autograph ball to play with. I mean, instead of using a priceless collectible, they could have just stopped playing baseball for the day. Like, if I was on this team and Benny destroyed the ball, I'd be like, oh, thank God we can stop playing. Smalls hits his first home run and tells them that they have to get the ball back because it belonged to his stepdad.
Some lady gave it to him. She even signed her name on it. Baby Ruth!
Babe Ruth!
You're killing me, Smalls. So work begins trying to retrieve the ball, and they try and fail at a number of different things, and honestly, most of them would have worked if they would have just done them faster.
Initiate retrieval suction. Initiate retrieval suction.
Prepare to initiate retrieval suction number one.
Initiate retrieval suction number one.
Initiate retrieval suction number one now.
Like this one. Just turn them all on at once, children. You have like three different levels of communication to perform three different actions. They then go high tech with a remote controlled erector set catapult, which again, just makes more commotion than anything else. Like use the remote control robot to lure the beast away and then use the pot on a stick thing again. Kids are stupid. And I am including myself in that statement. I wouldn't have been able to build anything near as cool as that when I was their age. Like, I would have plans to build something cool like a catapult robot, but with zero engineering ability, it would just be like a bucket on a skateboard. But then I would just draw a blank with how to make it do anything, and then I would just give up. That night, Benny has a dream about Babe Ruth, and the babe tells Benny to just jump over the fence and get it, because this is his one chance to do something great. And when that chance comes, you have to take it or else regret it for the rest of your life. I can relate. I once had a chance to meet Sinbad when he was signing autographs at the mall, and I told everyone at school that my brother was going to take me that weekend, but he had to work. And let me tell you, showing up that Monday without a Sinbad autograph, worst f***ing day of my life. And if there had been someone named, oh, I don't know, Jake Springer in class, do you think he would have let that shit go? You didn't meet Sinbad either, Jake! Although his dad did get Superfly Jimmy Snuka to come to his birthday party. So they meet at the Sandlot, and Benny got new PF Flyers, which were guaranteed to make you run faster and jump higher, and I always love that they are basically just a newer version of the shoes he already has. That shows that marketing works. And then something happens which completely takes you out of the movie because it's just so fake.
You don't have to do this.
Benny, don't do it.
Yeah, don't do it, Benny.
All of Benny's friends beg him not to do something incredibly stupid. Any group of boys like this might have one or two that kind of half-heartedly try to warn you not to do something dangerous, but they all secretly kind of want to see what happens. Then you have the kids who just completely egg you on and say extremely hurtful things to goad you into it, like, let's continue to use the completely imaginary Jake Springer, who dares you to, oh gosh, let's say, lick a dog turd that was on the playground. And in this made-up situation, you really don't want to, because it's gross. But then Jake Springer starts making threateningly cryptic statements alluding to the fact that he most definitely saw you practicing kissing on one of those pillow people, the one that was designed to look like a window to be specific. So in order to keep him quiet, you would do it, and then you would get very sick from licking dog feces, and you would learn all about negative attention, and how people are laughing at you, not with you. So Benny hops the fence, and the beast drops the ball taunting him. Benny races for the ball and jumps over the fence, but the beast breaks free from his chain and chases Benny all through town. Benny leads the dog through a picnic in the park in the hopes that the dog will attack someone else, but to no avail. The dog wants to murder only Benny. Benny leads the beast back to the Sandlot and jumps the fence into Mr. Myrtle's yard, and the beast busts through the fence and it collapses on him. The beast is seriously hurt, and unfortunately the only thing you can do in this situation is to bash the dog's head in with a large rock to put him out of his misery. Or you could try to lift the fence off him. That is also a viable option. But in my defense, That fence could have been the only thing keeping the beast alive, like Mel Gibson's wife in Signs. The beast is alive and he ends up being nice. And they finally knock on Mr. Myrtle's door, and he says that he would have gotten the ball for them if they would have just asked. And he invites Benny and Smalls inside, where he has a large selection of baseball memorabilia.
Signed by Babe Ruth.
George signed this?
George Herman Ruth? Yeah.
Now come on, Smalls. Up until yesterday, you thought Babe Ruth was a woman. Just because you looked up his full name today doesn't mean you can use that information to trick a blind man into thinking you're a baseball fan. That's just sick. Like, Benny is too nice, but any of the other kids would be rolling their eyes at you right now. Mr. Myrtle offers to trade Smalls' Babe Ruth signed ball for one that was signed by the entire 1927 Yankees. It's revealed that Mr. Myrtle was a pro baseball player and was good friends with Babe Ruth.
You guys come by here once a week and talk baseball with me. We'll call it an even trade.
Deal!
Oh man, Smalls has to talk baseball with his old man every week? He's gonna have to learn the middle names of like so many baseball players to keep up this ruse.
Did I ever tell you about the time that Hank Aaron
and- You mean Henry Louis Aaron?
You need to stop doing that.
So Smalls gives Bill the murderer's row ball and told him that he ruined the Babe Ruth autograph ball.
Oh, you got your friends in a pickle and you couldn't even get yourself out of it? You had to have your friend do it? In my f***ing day, kids had to get themselves out of their own pickles. Cucumbers, zucchinis, even our own asparagus. Made our f***ing piss smell all f***ing day. Did we complain and cry? No. We just f***ing took care of it. Today's kids are all like, oh, please, Benny, can you almost get eaten by a dog because I was stupid enough to steal my stepdad's autographed Babe Ruth ball? You really thought Babe Ruth was a woman? And this chick signed a baseball? And I displayed it in my f***ing den? Let's say it was from a f***ing broad. Why the f*** would that make it okay for you to give it to Ray f***ing Charles? Thanks for absolutely nothing, my new wife's kid.
Smalls then says that they all lived in the neighborhood for a few more years, but that every time someone moved away, they never replaced him on the team.
Squints grew up and married Wendy Peppercorn. They have 9 kids. They bought Vincent's drugstore and they still own it to this day.
So Squints was actually able to get with Wendy Peppercorn, but now he's saddled with 9 kids working at a drugstore? That is a definite monkey's paw situation going on right there. Benny became a local legend and was given the nickname Benny the Jet Rodriguez, and he grew up to play for the Dodgers. Smalls grew up to be a sports announcer, and he's calling a Dodgers game when the Jet steals home.
He's stealing home and they don't see him! I don't believe it! They don't see him! The pitch! There's a throw! It's in the dirt! He's safe! The Jets stole home! The Jets stole home!
And the two best friends exchange a thumbs up, and it's the most heartwarming thing you've ever seen in your life. And that was The Sandlot, a movie that takes you back to the carefree days of your youth, playing with your friends, getting into mischief, and not being pranked and teased mercilessly by a festering malignant tumor named Jake. How does being able to throw a baseball help you in hell, Jake?
It's good to be alive right about now.